السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى بهديه واقتدى بسنته إلى يوم الدين وبعد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We continue now, inshallah, with the seerah of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And we had mentioned on Thursday that we had concluded with one entire chapter of the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which is known as the Makkan period or the Makkan era, the 13 years that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had spent as a prophet after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had commissioned him with Nubuwa, the 13 years that he spent in Mecca, plus the years of his coming into this world up until then. We have discussed those years. Now, inshallah, we will begin with a new chapter. And this new chapter is, it begins with the hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum from Makkatul Mukarramah to Madinatul Munawwara. Now, before we actually mention the actual hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam himself, we will make mention of a few points regarding the hijrah and the hijrah of those who had migrated before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then of course, later on in the series, we will, perhaps tomorrow, we will speak about the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam himself. So now, we know from earlier episodes that the Nubuwa prophethood initiated with pure, pious dreams of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was seeing these dreams. Similarly, on the same note, the hijrah had also initiated with these pure, pious dreams that were seen by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is seeing these dreams, and in these dreams, the location of where the hijrah was going to be made by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had inspired Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in these dreams, was shown to him. The location was shown, but the actual area, the name of the place or the city to which Rasulullah ﷺ would make this hijrah, this was not shown to Rasulullah ﷺ in the dreams. It's like, for instance, somebody tells you, they ask you rather, where do you live? I live by Midland and Eglinton, Midland and Lawrence. That's one of the closest main intersections to this masjid here in Scarborough. So I live by Midland and Lawrence. That's the location. But what is the specific address, like what we would use in today's terms? I live at so-and-so, perhaps building or condo or house number. So similarly, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is shown the location of where he is going to make this hijrah in these dreams that he is seeing before the hijrah is made. However, he hasn't been shown exactly which place, which city is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala selected for the grand migration of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba from Makkatul Mukarramah. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was shown in a dream roughly that there were date palms in that area. Now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't know. This could have been, of course, Madinatul Munawwara. It could have also been Yamama, which is also, you know, there's numerous, there's a great amount of date palms found there as well. Or this could have also meant Hajar, another city that is, you know, it is abundant with date palms. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had seen that there were date palms in that location, that area, that city where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was going to make hijrah with the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, but he didn't know exactly which one of these cities it was that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was showing him inside of the dream. And while Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in this state of reflection, so I am going to make this hijrah, Allah has indicated to me that the hijrah is going to be made, But where is it that hijrah is going to be made? I don't know. Is it going to be this? Is it going to be that? Yes, there's going to be date palms. During the course of this reflection, after seeing these dreams, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would then ultimately reveal unto Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the exact location. And we all know that it was none other than the perhaps the greatest city, the second greatest city on planet Earth, and that is Madinatul Munawwara. It was shown to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through divine revelation that the city to which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba would be making hijrah from Makkatul Mukarramah, where persecution and untold suffering and hardship had literally reached the max. It had reached the top. This was the pinnacle. This was the peak of pain and torment. After which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa would be given permission to make this hijrah. It was Madinatul Munawwara that was given the honor to host Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa in the Sahaba, and which would ultimately become the markaz. It would become the hub. It would become the headquarters for the dissemination of deen, of knowledge, of producing the greatest giants that this ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa would ever be able to produce. Now in the hadith of Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah, and of course we find it in other great books of hadith as well, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa had been told that whichever one of these three particular cities you were drawn to, that is the city that you would be given permission to make the hijrah to. So what were those cities? One, Madinatul Munawwara; two, Bahrain; and three, Qinasriyin. So these are the three cities that Rasulullah ﷺ was given an option to choose from, an option. Again, this is a different narration. In the previous one that was mentioned earlier on, it was the one that had an abundance of date palms. So that could have been different cities or different location, different areas. But in this Tirmidhi's riwayah, in the narration we find in Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah's book, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given an option to choose from one of the three, and whichever one he was drawn to, that is the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would make the place of migration of hijrah for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba. Just like, for instance, today we might find, I'm not exactly sure how it may be, but the trend in this city, of course this was pre-COVID-19, and sadly, we've lost a lot of these same scholars that I'm making mention of now using this analogy or this example. When some of these giants would come to our city, to Toronto namely, we would, you know, so many different individuals, they would offer their homes to host that honorable guest, some of whom have left this world in the last 3 months. I think it's been 124 days since all of this, the outbreak. Nevertheless, so they would try to compete, not compete necessarily, but they would hope, every one of them cherishes this hope, that I'll be given this honor to host so-and-so scholar, so-and-so buzurg, so-and-so sheikh, for instance, in my home. I want to be the one that has the opportunity to host him. He can be my guest. So you can imagine, this is the pride of the universe. This is the most exalted creation after Allah. I mean, after Allah, He is the most exalted, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it was different cities. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam opted for Madinatul Munawwara. Of course, we know after which that is the city that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chosen. It was decreed. It was divine predestination. This is what Allah had destined, that the city to which the hijrah would be made would be the great Madinatul Munawwara. So now, after the second bay'ah, the second pledge of allegiance in Aqaba, bay'atu Aqaba al-thaniya, what had happened, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam had told the Sahaba, he had instructed the Sahaba to prepare for the hijrah. Now the Sahaba radiallahu anhum have these mixed emotions. So on one hand, they're extremely frantic, they're awe-stricken, they're panicking like, whoa, what's happening? We're going to have to leave. We're leaving our homes behind. We're leaving our families behind. We're leaving our, this is our homeland. This is my city. This is where they were born and bred. And all of a sudden, because the difficult circumstances, because the situations become too uneasy for them, in order for them to continue continue to propagate the deen, in order for them to continue to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in peace, it's not going to be possible. Therefore, we're all going to make this hijrah. So they're being instructed to prepare. So on one hand, they're very frantic. They're very worried, for lack of better words. They're very panicking. But at the same time, they have to keep it a secret. So they can't let this state of their affairs become exposed to the people. Because if the people do find out, and we're going to come to find out just now ourselves, that once some of these disbelievers and arch enemies of Islam came to find out that the hijrah was being made by these certain sahaba, radiallahu anhum ajma'in, they didn't like it. They were furious about it. How is it possible that these people that we've been doing everything we can to tyrannize them, to do everything to punish them, if they escape their wretched hands, if they escape their grasp, their grip, that's it. We're not going to be able to punish those people anymore. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructs them. They begin the preparations for this hijrah. From all of the people who prepared, number one, the first to prepare for the hijrah was Abu Salma Abdul Asad Makhzumi radiyallahu an. Abu Salma radiyallahu an. Abu Salma Abdul Asad Makhzumi radiyallahu anhu, along with his wife and their son. These are the first three individuals to have prepared from Makkatul Mukarramah to take off to perform the great hijrah to Madinatul Munawwara. But it wasn't going to be so easy for the three of them. It was not going to be easy at all, rather. The moment the family of Salama, who is of course the wife of Abu Salama, when her family came to find out that they were trying to make this hijrah, leaving behind Makkatul Mukarramah, they said, no way is it going to be possible for you to leave with a woman of us, from us. She is from amongst us. She is from our tribe. There's no way that we are going to allow you, speaking to the husband, Abu Salma, that you are going to leave with her. You are going to have to keep her behind. Now, she is kept behind. So that is done by the tribe of the mother and the wife of Abu Salma. So they have a child. So Salma radiallahu anha's tribe has her taken away. She is gone. Now there's only Abu Salma radiallahu anhu. And the child, then the family, of course, of the father, they come and they snatch the child away from Salma radiallahu anha. They say, no, that this child, obviously, the lineage of the child goes to the father. This child is ours. We consider him ours, and therefore it is not permissible for you to perform this migration, for you to leave Mecca with our child. We are going to take him. So the mother's side takes the mother, the father's side takes the father, and Abu Salma radiallahu anhu is left all by his lonesome. A family that began, a family of three, hoping to make it to Madinatul Munawwara together, has now been split such that the father is alone and he will continue to proceed, move ahead until he makes the hijrah to Madinatul Munawwara. And the mother has been taken by her tribe and the son has been taken by the tribe of the father. The three of them have now been split apart. For one long year, this state of separation would continue. Salama radiallahu anha, she would go out every morning, every single day, and she would weep bitterly. You can imagine, her husband is gone, her son has been separated from her, all three of them have been separated. You can imagine the amount of pain, of separation that she is going through at this time. So, 1 year goes by like this. She says, I used to go out to a place called Abtah every single morning. And every day I would repeat the same schedule. I would go there and I would weep and weep profusely and bitterly. And I would come back, hoping that something would come about. Finally, after a very long period of time, when the cousins of Salama radiallahu anha, they complained to Banu al-Mughira, which is of course her tribe. Banu al-Mughira is the tribe of Umm Salma radiallahu anha. So her cousins complained to them that you are going to have to let her leave. You are going to have to release her, allow her to go back to Makkah al-Mukarramah to meet up with her husband for once and for all. So they felt pity for her. They allowed Umm Salama radiallahu anha to go. Umm Salama radiallahu anha spent 1 year in this manner. Finally, after one long year, she's been given the permission to go and join her husband in Madinatul Munawwara. And at the same time, she has finally been reunited with her child. So Umm Salama radiallahu anha, now along with her child, she proceeds. The first one to make the hijrah, Abu Salma, Abdul Asad Makhzumi radiallahu anhu, the father and the husband, he has already made it, he has already proceeded ahead. Now there is his wife and child that he left behind. They will continue to make the hijrah all by themselves. She would proceed further. She would continue ahead further away from Makkah in the direction of Madinatul Munawwara. And finally she comes to a place by the name of Tan'im. When Umm Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha comes to Tan'im, there she is met by a very amazing individual who had not until then yet accepted Islam. Uthman bin Talha, who would later on become a Sahabi. Nevertheless, Uthman bin Talha sees Umm Salama radiallahu anha. She is by herself, she has her son, she's traveling these distances, traversing the lands. So he asks her, where are you going? Umm Salama radiallahu anha replies, I am going to meet up and join with my husband. And then he asks, okay, who is with you? She says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and my son. That is all I have with me. Uthman bin Talha, after seeing that this was her condition, he almost begins to cry. What he does now, he grabs the reins of his camel, he walks in front of her, of Umm Salama radiallahu anha, and he asks her to mount the camel. She mounts the camel with her son, and now he is the one who is leading the camel, and he is proceeding ahead with her, mounted on the camel and her son. And he would continue like this the entire journey. Uthman bin Talha has not until now accepted Islam while this incident is taking place. Nevertheless, Uthman bin Talha, he continues to move. Every time they have to halt, they have to come to a stop, the camel would sit, he would move away, then he would get off, or she would get off of the camel, he would take the reins of the camel, he would go a far distance, and then he would tie the camel to a tree, after which he would rest under the shade of that tree. And then when it was time for us to proceed further, after having taken some rest, we would continue to proceed further. And then just before, of course, doing so, he would bring the camel to me and he would have me mount on the camel. He would tell me, come on, let's go. I would mount the camel. He would take the reins of the camel and then he would continue. We continued like this. And every time we had to halt and come to a stop, this was exactly the same state of affairs. This was Umm Salama radiallahu anha says, I had never seen a more gracious, a more noble man in all of the people of that time. A more noble and gracious man in the people of that time, meaning those perhaps from amongst the disbelievers or the people of Mecca. Nevertheless, I was amazed by this individual. I've never seen somebody like this. He, from the moment he asked me where I was headed to, whither to, and with whom I was, from that moment onwards, he continued and continued, traverses the entire journey until finally, just as we came close to Quba. Quba is very close to Madinatul Munawwara. We all know when we perform the Hajj and Umrah, the tour guides take us there. So she says, when I came to Quba, it was then where he pointed to me a small area and told me that this is where your husband is living. After pointing to me that my husband was staying there, he told me that you should enter with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And like this, he delivered me to the home of my husband, and off he went and returned to Makkah. I had never seen somebody noble and gracious like this. This is what the hijrah of the first family making hijrah from Makkah to Madinatul Munawwara look like. Then we go on. There was Amir bin Rabia with his wife Layla bin Khaythama. Then there was Abu Ahmad and his brother Abdullah bin Jahash radiallahu anhu. Abdullah bin Jahash, the great Sahabi radiallahu anhu, who was martyred in the Battle of Uhud. So him, Abdullah, and his brother Abu Ahmad bin Jahash, they were going in order. So first you have Abu Salama and Umm Salama with their son. Then you have Amir bin Rabia with his wife Layla bin Khaythama. Now you have Abu Ahmad and his brother Abdullah bin Jahash radiallahu anhu with their families. And then while they were about to leave, Utbah, who was of course we know a very great enemy of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and an arch enemy of Islam, when he saw this, when he saw that the people were starting to leave one by one, they were leaving their homes vacant, their homes were just empty, he said a few words. He said, "Kullu darin wa in talat salamatuha yawman satudrikuha an-nakba'u wal-hubu." No matter, every single home, a day would ultimately come when it would become deserted and it would become empty. This is the state of every single home in this world. He is seeing these homes of the residents, of the believers of Mecca become empty. So he is reminded of these words. Nevertheless, we move forward. And then he says, this is all because of our nephew. Of course, he is referring to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is responsible for such a turbulent division within our society. Nevertheless, then there's a great group of the believers who would make hijrah. From amongst them, there is Ukasha bin Mihsan, Uqba bin Wahab, Shuja'a bin Wahab, Arbad bin Jamira, or Arbad bin Jamira. There's Munqidh bin Nabata, Sa'id bin Ruqaysh, Muhriz bin Nadla, Yazid bin Ruqaysh, Qais bin Jabir, Amr bin Mihsan, Safwan bin Amr, Thaqif bin Amr, Rabia bin Aktham, Zubair bin Ubaid, Tamam ibn Ubaidah, Sanjara bin Ubaidah, and Muhammad ibn Jahsh radiallahu anhum. These are from amongst the men. From amongst the women, there is also those that are making hijrah. Zainab bint Jahsh, Ummi Habiba bint Jahsh, Juzama bint Jundul, Ummu Qais bint Mihsan, Ummu Habib bint Thumama, Amina bint Ruqaysh, Sanjara bint Tamim, and Hamna bint Jahsh radiallahu anhun ajma'in. So they are the men and women who are, now we're going in order. After the groups that we have already made mention of, these are those who are making the hijrah, and they are proceeding from Makkah to Al-Mukarramah to Medina to Al-Munawwara. Now there is Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu, and there is also with him a sahabi by the name of Ayyash bin Rabi'ah radiallahu anhuma. These two would be making the hijrah, cherishing hope that they would reach Medina to Al-Munawwara, not knowing, of course, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed for them. Umar radiallahu anhu, and with them are 20 other sahaba radiallahu anhum who are mounted on horses, all intending to make this hijrah. They would all make it, but Hisham bin As was prevented. So they would make it, and now there's another sahabi, Hisham bin As radiallahu anhu, he was prevented. So Umar and Ayyash radiallahu anhuma, they reached Madinatul Munawwara. Abu Jahl and his brother Harith, they came to Medina and they told Ayyash. They lied to him, they deceived him. So Abu Jahl and his brother come to Ayyash and they say, "Listen, Ayyash, your mother has promised, she has vowed that she is not going to eat anything and she is going to continue to stand under the sun. She will not take shade under anything if you do not return to Makkatul Mukarramah at once." Ayyash bin Rabi'ah didn't know the evil plot of these people. He just, his heart melted at the fact that his mother was putting herself through so much hardship and difficulty. Simply, this is what he was thinking, simply because he has separated himself from her. He is doing it for Allah and for the Prophet of Allah and for the deen. But when he hears the mother, his importance that he has for his mother makes his heart melt. He has been told that she is not going to not eat, she is not going to comb her hair, she is going to live in this disheveled manner, and she is not going to take shade under anything until you return to Mecca. Ayyash bin Rabi ultimately agreed. And so he hopes he is going to go back to Mecca with Abu Jahl and his brother Harith. And as they go, as they begin their return from where they are towards Makkatul Mukarramah, Abu Jahl and his brother Harith, they tie his hands behind his back and they begin to torture him mercilessly. And as long as he was there, shackled, he was tied up by Abu Jahl and his brother, they continued to put him through untold hardship and difficulty, physically torturing him. He was thinking that I am going back to please my mother so she will relieve herself of this unnecessary pain that she is taking upon herself because I've separated from her. Little did he know about the lies and the deception of these enemies of Allah. When he intends to return with them, they chain him up or they tie him up and they begin to torture him like this. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while he, Ayash bin Rabi'ah radiallahu anhu, is in this state, he is being tortured, he is being put through hardship. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in Madinatul Munawwara. He is still in Madinatul Munawwara. He is making dua qunut in Salatul Fajr. The dua qunut that we make at a time when there is a calamity. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is making dua qunut for three individual sahaba. Walid ibn al-Walid, Ayash bin Rabi'ah, and another sahabi. These three sahaba radiallahu anhum, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is making dua of qunut for. Ayash bin Rabi'ah, after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would make this dua, he would say, Oh Allah, grant them, save them, save these three individuals. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is making dua, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes a way out for him, and ultimately Ayash bin Rabi'ah radiallahu anhu manages to escape and joins the rest of the Sahaba in Madinatul Munawwara. So by this time, there are so many other Sahaba radiallahu anhum who have also joined those who are already in Madinatul Munawwara. And we take their names again. Then there is, so the dua Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was making, O Allah, deliver Walid ibn al-Walid, Salama bin Hisham, the second Sahabi, Salama bin Hisham, and the third one, of course, Ayash bin Rabi'ah, from the persecution of the Mushrikeen. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made the dua, Allah released him from this agony, and he fled to Medina. So then there is, after those who have made hijrah, after Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu, there is his brother, Zayd bin Khattab radiallahu anhu. Now there's a difference of opinion, because Umar radiallahu anhu used to say, my brother Zayd beat me to two things. He beat me to accepting Islam, and he also beat me to making the hijrah. So there's a difference of opinion here, but nevertheless, Zayd bin Khattab radiallahu anhu beat Umar bin Khattab in accepting Islam and in becoming a shaheed. Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu beat him in making the hijrah. Umar radiallahu anhu has also already made the hijrah. Joining him now is his brother Zayd bin Khattab radiallahu anhu. And then there's Amr and Abdullah, who are the sons of Suraqa radiallahu anhu, Khunais bin Hudhaifa Sahmi, Sa'id bin Amr bin Nufail, Waqid bin Abdullah Tamimi, Khawla bin Khawla, Malik bin Abi Khawla, and the four sons of Bukayr. So they are Iyas, Amir, Aqil, and Khalid. And then there's another huge procession, a group of people that join them. Some of the greatest names, Talha bin Ubaidullah, Suhayb bin Sinan, Hamza bin Abdul Muttalib, Zayd bin Haritha, Abu Marfad, Kanaz ibn Hassan, Anasa, Abu Kabsha, Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Harith, and his two brothers, Tufail and Harith, Tufail bin Harith and Hussein bin Harith. There's Mistah bin Athatha, Suwayt bin Sa'd, Tulay bin Umair, Khabbab ibn al-Arat, Abdurrahman ibn Awf, Zubair ibn al-Awwam. These two are also from amongst the Ashara Mubashara. Abu Sabra bin Abi Riham, or Mus'ab bin Umair, Abu Mus'ab bin Umair, Abu Hudhaifa bin Utba, Salim, who is the emancipated slave of Abu Hudhaifa, Utba bin Ghazwan, and Uthman bin Affan, radiyallahu anhum ajma'een. Virtually, basically, eventually, gradually, all of the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum have migrated now from Mecca to Medina. Only those who have stayed behind, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and with him, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, and with them, Ali bin Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu. Apart from these three illustrious individuals, there are probably a few vulnerable sahaba radiyallahu anhu who have still been, they're still stuck, they're trapped in the clutches of the disbelievers. But apart from them, everybody else has already made hijrah from Makkatul Mukarramah to Madinatul Munawwara. And inshaAllah, tomorrow we will continue with the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah.